Hello, I'm Roberta Byrd, and today we're face to face with Seattle.
During the tumultuous days of the 60s and 70s, as moderator of Face to Face, Roberta Byrd shared with us stories no one else told or dared to tell.
All right, that's one man's opinion. Let's ask another man.
Only because they just don't want you to tear down the city.
Long ago it must be, I have a photograph, preserve your memories, where all that's left in you.
I never thought I'd be alive 70 years.
Didn't you?
Oh, no.
Why not?
I started out with such a shaky beginning in life. My father, you know, he's been dead 50 years and I still hate his guts. Isn't that horrible? I was kind of abandoned.
So you were abandoned by both your mother and father?
Not by my mother, but she couldn't do anything about it. And as black people have been doing since time immemorial, somebody said, no, we'll take her. That's how I survived. And it was a thing that black people did. You didn't let any child lie out in the no man's land. Somebody took you in. I went to elementary school outside of Tacoma. All teachers were white. You couldn't get a job in a school district in the state of Washington cleaning toilets if you were not white. And just the memory of those white teachers reminds me always that not all white people are horrible, which would be easy to conclude. In the state of Washington, the only things available were prostitution or being someone's housekeeper. I did not wish to do either one, so I busied myself in getting a scholarship and got out of here.
Roberta attended all-black Wilberforce University in Ohio. Two marriages ended in divorce, and with her two teenage sons, she moved to Seattle.
I was divorced from Dr. Byrd and decided to return home because the East has always been a mystery to me. I do not understand the Eastern people at all. So I came home to live with my mother, which I'm sure, as people are now, when their sons and daughters return home, I say, oh my Lord. But nevertheless, here I was. So I thought, well, what is it that I really want to do? And that's to teach.
Soon after becoming a teacher, Roberta gained notoriety during the boycott of the schools. She was one of three teachers out of 5,000 in the district to join the boycott and was principal of the Freedom School.
The purpose was to point up the need to desegregate the schools.
And they promoted you?
I don't think they promoted me because I struck the schools. I don't know why they promoted me. I like to think they promoted me because I was pretty good at what I did.
And indeed, she was good at what she did. Roberta ended up being the first woman and the first black to be principal of a major Seattle high school. She was vice principal of Franklin, and then principal of Lincoln High.
It was always interesting to me when this interracial group would come into my office. I had an open door, and you always knew when you were about to be manipulated. And if they manipulated you in the direction that you already wanted to go, it was just fine.
With Roberta's non-judgmental and fair treatment of all students and her wisdom with the teachers, she was soon considered to be one of the best principals in Seattle's history. Despite her challenging jobs in education during the 50s and 60s, Roberta found time to make additional contributions to Seattle's cultural and civic awareness. In 1961, she starred in Raisin in the Sun, a hit play that pioneered in opening up jobs for black actors and brought additional attention to the multi-talents of Roberta. In reviewing this play, Seattle columnist Emmett Watson wrote, "She has such a beautiful voice. I could listen to her read the telephone book."
My name is Roberta Byrd, the name of the program, Face to Face.
And that voice and Roberta were soon to be heard across the Northwest in a weekly television show hosted by Roberta.
Hello, I'm Roberta Byrd.
Face to Face was the first and only local TV series in the nation to consistently cover minorities. Many television viewers soon would not miss Roberta's fearless honesty and her empathy with individuals never before seen on television.
And you think this is happening?
I think it is happening.
The big issues were, of course, poverty and the programs initiated to deal with them, segregated schools, and Vietnam.
Sergeant Shriver, the right-wing white community and the left-wing black community are in bed together against the war on poverty. What is your attitude toward this?
They look upon the war against poverty as an enemy of their own private and personal objectives. I hope that the vast majority of Americans will stand together in support of these programs which have passed the test of the United States Senate, for example, stand in support of them for the good of our country, black and white, rich and poor, north, south, east and west.
Senator Magnuson, if as is possible, these programs are diffused throughout the various bureaucracies in Washington, what would happen to them?
I would think that it would be the beginning of the end. This is based upon local initiative, local participation, community action. I think that would wither on the vine, and that would be the end of the program, insofar as successes we'd like to have.
The war against poverty is a program or a series of programs, a number of programs, the purpose of which is to motivate people to help themselves. We're trying to motivate the people who have it to do something beneficial or helpful, cooperative with the people who haven't got it. And we're trying to convince them that the people who haven't got it are good people who would work if they had a chance to do it. I think the Community Action Program as an idea, as a concept, as a new idea, is an extremely important one. I'd almost say a revolutionary one for changing the living conditions of people in this country.
As brief as the poverty program was, I think an awful lot of us felt hopeful that this will make a difference. It did not last long enough to make a difference. It lasted just long enough to raise hopes and then have them vanish.
Things do you think ought to be happening right in the Negro community?
Do you get a feeling that the rest of the community is happy about your promotion?
They just don't want you to tear down the city. What is the most important problem?
Getting jobs, you know, and able to go on and apply for jobs.
The young black male is in massive trouble, in my view. But there are an awful lot of terribly put upon, abused, poor white kids in this country. And they look at anything that seems to give a non-white a leg up, and they say, why them? Why not me? I live a horrible life, and many do.
When a fellow is out of a job, and your kids have big patches all over their knees, when a fellow is out of a job, there's no juice in the earth, no salt in the sea, no ginger in life in this land of the free. And the universe.
Attempts by Tyree Scott and other blacks to end discrimination in the building trades met with strong opposition.
The man asked me to ask him a question. I was asking him a question.
And the deal is we don't mind the blacks coming in the union, but we want them to serve the same amount of apprenticeship we served. I served 5 years apprenticeship. They served 5 years apprenticeship. Not 6 months and get the same pay I'm getting.
Well, I feel, that the unions are open, for the opportunities for the black. I've had a son, that went under the same rules, and I feel that, it stays for all of us.
We want them! We want them!
Who authorizes you to spend taxpayers' money like that?
This amounts to a drop in the bucket of what has to be done to alleviate poverty and racial discrimination.
I've been up there meeting with your committee.
Okay.
I can't answer all these questions at once, if you don't mind.
All right, now, if you want to hear the answer to the question, somebody's going to have to listen.
All right, let's listen.
What we talked about was some program to get more people opportunity to work in this area.
Face to Face not only covered blacks who were striving for better jobs, but also seldom heard from Mexican-American workers.
Mexican Americans. There are 5 million of them in the United States. About 5,000 are expected this summer in the Skagit Valley and in Whatcom County, from Seattle north to the Canadian border. A minority which is worse off in every respect than any other non-whites, including Negroes and Indians. A fact attested to by this film taken in and around Yakima Valley. Mexican Americans are poorer, their housing more crowded and dilapidated, their unemployment rate higher, their average education level lower, their school dropout rate higher than any other group in our nation. In Washington State, the average life expectancy is 38 years. 32 years less than that of other Americans. Many think of Mexican Americans in terms of wetbacks who cross the border to fester in farm shacks for miserly wages, and all too many do. But increasingly, they are coming to the cities. In fact, already in the Southwest, almost 80% are urbanized. Here in Seattle, we have an increasing population of this minority. Let's meet a few on our show today.
But sometimes, face-to-face programs did not go as planned. Bluma's Delicatessen was to be an example of how well the black community was getting along with the Jewish community. Roberta filmed at the Delicatessen, but the day before the program was to air, she had to change plans. The police raided the Delicatessen and found that the Bluma brothers were selling marijuana in the bagels and other drugs to students of nearby Garfield High School.
And then I called my good friend, whose name I'm not going to mention, and said, what can we do about this? Because he was Jewish. And he said, well, how will they earn a living? I've never gotten over that. And then the police, his lawyer, came and got the film. Do you remember that? And it was never shown? It was a very traumatic experience for me. Because that store, although the young men went away to prison, they didn't go away right away.
He had a big old shotgun, shit.
Did the blacks get together and boycott?
I think the black community did get together and try to drive the store out of the community, and they obviously succeeded. It's been a long time since it's been there. During the height of the civil rights movement, we had a few disturbances. I don't think you could call them riots as compared to Watts or Cleveland or wherever else. The Black Panthers were here. I remember when they came to my school at Franklin. And the entire faculty, as I recall, was frightened, but I wasn't. They were just young black men trying to make a statement. I wasn't afraid of them. And I was very put out with all the people who were, because they were very intimidating. with their uniforms and their guns and all that sort of thing, but I knew they weren't going to shoot me or anybody else. They were playing a role which they felt deeply involved in and meant, but they weren't going to kill anybody. The Black Panthers in Seattle didn't do anything to anybody at any time, ever.
One thing that makes me unhappy about you and other young men like you is that you...
When Leroy Jones, poet and playwright whose work was politically charged with black nationalism, came to Seattle, Roberta took him on.
I see really no difference between the black segregationist and the white segregationist. And I think that you and the Grand Kleagle of some clan in some unknown city have far more in common than either of you has with the great mass of the American people.
I've been writing quite a while now. I've won a lot of awards. You know, I've taught writing. I'm an accomplished writer. I can write very well.
I think so.
A lot of people say that. Even crackers will tell you I can write very well.
Mm-hmm.
But people don't want to produce my plays.
You know that you cannot put on the kind of plays that you've been writing on television. You
well,
know that.
Why not, though? That's what I want to know.
Well, I don't
why
think.
Not?
I think that they are obscene.
The idea of what part one played as a moderate got earned one some very unpleasant names like Uncle Tom or Aunt Thomasina or Oreo and all that sort of thing. I think the thing that killed the poverty program was Vietnam. The young people who had been working in those areas were now engaged in trying to preserve themselves from being killed in a war they thought was wrong.
So we think that the anti-war movement has become a mass movement. And the one thing that's become clear is that with the negotiations going on, coming to nothing, with the escalation, with the various games that Nixon plays and trying to figure out how he can make it look like he's withdrawing troops without actually taking anybody out of South Vietnam, it's become clear that the central demand of more and more peoples is just simply cut the plane around, bring the troops home now, stop it.
These so-called national leaders are going to come to us and they're going to try and tell us about the whoops theory of American history, you know? How did nice guys like us get in a place like that?
Being outnumbered is hardly new to policemen, but conditions for Seattle police were unique recently as thousands of students and others poured into Seattle streets to protest an unpopular war and the deaths of four students at Kent University in Ohio early this month. Policemen were cast in new roles as they faced the multitude. It's one thing to face a robber or a burglar alone or in groups. These incidents are cut and dry. The offender is clearly breaking the law against property, and the public does not condone such actions. But police were now facing a situation which had more than normal public support. How could they keep order when some students were clearly breaking the law? If students want the freedom to demonstrate, do they still have to respect the ground rules? And under these conditions, what are the ground rules? And if a person resists a policeman whose job it is to uphold the law and keep order, then is not that person against the law? To quote one Seattle policeman, "I just don't understand the whole thing. Damn it, we're expected to do a job, but everybody yells brutality when we take action. It just doesn't figure. What does the public want?" Hello, I'm Roberta Byrd, and today we're face to face with Seattle police and one university student. Is it too much to ask a policeman to keep his cool when pelleted with bottles, rocks, wastebaskets, and bricks, as indeed these officers were? A policeman was overheard to say, "As long as they keep in line, there's no problem." Then a couple of militants get them going with name-calling, and that sets it off. You ever been hit with a rock when you're not expecting it? We don't like to use our sticks, and when we do, we're criticized. Aren't we allowed to protect ourselves? But 3 weeks ago, use their sticks they did. At the end of four tense days of demonstrations and an evening of rock throwing and window breaking on May 7th, many believe the police were out of control and using inexcusable violence. Mayor Ullman's office has received many affidavits from students who before that day on May 7th were not radicals. Sworn statements of unwarranted beatings of innocent citizens who were trying to return home or were attempting to keep the peace.
These kids are not all bad. I think that there's an area of protest that they have a right to.
Their basic ideas are the right ideas, but some of their means of trying to prove this I don't approve of.
Whether people, I think, realize it or not, or want to realize it, I think we're in the midst of a revolution.
And the women's liberation movement was possibly more far-reaching and revolutionary than the anti-war movement.
Yes, she does. She makes love just like a woman. Yes, she does. And she thinks just like a woman. But she breaks just like a little girl.
Good afternoon. The song you've just heard by Bob Dylan is, I'm sure you all know, a takeoff, a satire on a stereotype of women. Women are not really playing that role, not entirely anymore. The women's liberation movement has grown in part out, most people believe, of the general protest movements which have shaken our country in the 1960s. Women have been active participants in civil rights demonstrations, in Poor People's Campaign of 1968, in the university protests, in the anti-draft and anti-war activities, such as this Red Cross worker who climbed over a protester to bring daffodils to General Hershey, or this young woman who chose a flower as her weapon. It's quite logical that out of such activism, women would begin questioning their own plight, particularly younger women, part of a rebellious generation who are a fertile ground for seeds of discontent. Concerned with overpopulation, they are having fewer babies. Looking ahead to living longer, they are thinking more about careers which add more action and dimension than their mothers had.
Roberta went on to explore many facets of the women's liberation movement on Face to Face, including sex on campus and abortion.
Thing, I don't think there's any more sex on campus than there ever has been. It's just that people are a bit more open about it.
Well, you read in the magazines about how it's only 25% of girls that aren't virgins. Well, I think that may be true, but that's still a lot more than it used to be.
Well, definitely they're more open, and they talk about it openly now. As well as I imagine sex is practiced more widely on campus than in the past.
You know, it's a combination of people being more open out here and also changing time.
You're pregnant and now you have a decision to make.
Well,
do I have the baby or do I not have a baby? How did you come to the conclusion that you should have an abortion?
Well, I think it was probably 75% my mother's decision.
Once you decided to have the abortion, was there a long time before you could find somebody who would perform the abortion?
I told my mother on a Thursday, and I had the abortion on Sunday.
The potential of young black women was one of Roberta's favorite topics.
I'm Roberta Byrd, and today's topic is to be a woman, young, gifted, and black. Last week, two university women, white, talked about their views of themselves and the causes to which they were committed. This week, we explore with black university women, or those who have been in university recently, their views of themselves, the total black condition, and the causes, principles, and directions in which they wish to go. Where does the black woman stand in the hierarchy of acceptance and personhood today? Is she her own woman, free to pursue her own femininity, goals and aspirations? Or is she still trying hard to be a copy of America's stated views of what women ought to be? White women, that is. America's ideal woman is seen around the world thanks to television, films, and billboards. She is usually blonde, a sex symbol with a brilliant thin-lipped smile, and a provocative chassis. Until several years ago, the ideal black woman was supposed to look like the ideal white woman. And if she did, she was acceptable. This Clairol ad from Ebony Magazine of 1967 makes the point. Notice the light skin, the Caucasian features, and the straightened hair. It reads, "Why not put color in your life when even a slight change makes a beautiful difference?" However, during the past few years, to an enlightened few, black has become beautiful. And even Miss Clairol has come a long way. In this ad of 1969, observe the natural hair, the darker skin, and it reads, "The new blue-black discovery for hair that looks completely natural."
I hope that the women's movement and Hispanic and Native American, all the rest of them, are doing better than we are, because we're really not doing well, except as individuals. There are many individuals, black individuals, who are doing well, and they would not be doing well if it hadn't been for the 60s.
Time it was, and what a time it was. A time of innocence, a time of comfort.